afternoon. Thank you, Sairi, for this opportunity. My apologies. I'm going to make you a little more late than you already are. But yeah, I'm a compulsive storyteller, and I'm determined to tell you the full story today. I've got really smart friends, and my mother's very sharp as well. And if at any point through this presentation you think, wow, this woman is so awesome, you know the credit goes to that woman at the back of the room here. She looks just like me. You'll be able to tell. Why I say my friends are really smart is because every time I cross a milestone in my life, I'll get a message from someone. This is what you were born to do. Why didn't you do this sooner? And I'll be like, I can barely understand what I'm doing in the first place. But I'm here because this year, I've been a media professional most of my career. I'm a teacher. I've been a journalist and a filmmaker. This year, in February, Rohit Bhatia and I, Rohit is a designer, we got together and we launched an online fashion label called Ochre Sky. And 3 months into this venture, my husband at the breakfast table looked at me and he said, can you just remind me why you've started this? Because my phone was buzzing. There were, you know, notifications coming from everywhere. He'd seen me. I'd been up for a while. Rohit calls about 20 times a day, and I call him back an equal number of times. And, you know, my household is saying, what's going on here? What suddenly happened? And it's a really good question, because he's got a couple of small businesses of his own in different cities. I've got two or three work roles as a freelancer, and we have three children between us. But my children didn't need to ask me this question. They somehow seem to know, like children often know. In fact, my daughter, who's 11 years old, my oldest daughter, she brought me a word the other day, and she said, Mama, what is this word? And I looked at it, and I said, this is entrepreneur. And you know what an entrepreneur is? And I struggle, and she says, I know. And I said, what do you know? And she says, you know, in English, when Sridevi was making laddus, and her husband was mocking her. And then she went to this language school, and her teacher told her, ah, you're an entrepreneur. So I know what it means. I said, well, your mama's one too. And she was kind of proud of me, because if I'm doing something that Sridevi's doing, then that must be okay. My first work role, like Anu mentioned, was as a videographer. I was one of the first women in India to take on the role of a news camera person. I joined NDTV in 1995. I was there for 13 years. And we were very privileged. We had a fantastic workspace. And almost every 2 years, I changed work roles. And we were able to do that because we were in a very flexible place where the growth was possible. But these changes in work roles weren't always going up. Sometimes they were going like this, and sometimes it was a steep, downward curve. And that happened when 8 years into my job at NDTV, when I had been a camera person, I had become very senior in the department. My colleague and I, we had become documentary filmmakers. We had traveled all over the world and brought back these three documentaries that then traveled to various festivals and are screened on NDTV even now. After that, I got married and I had my first child. And when I came back, I didn't want to travel anymore for a while. So I didn't want to be a producer, and I didn't want to be a reporter, and I didn't want to be a camera person, and I didn't want a desk job. So I chose to become an editor. And I hadn't really edited till then. We had new technology in the office. They were non-linear editing suites. And the first couple of days when I went into work in the morning shift because I wanted to go back home early, there was this kind of silence around me. Because here was this Natasha that everybody knew, who everybody kind of spoke about, because I did all these fascinating things with the camera. And she had been head of the camera department. And now she had entered the editing department at the bottom. And I remember on the second or the third day, I just couldn't get anything done. The machine wouldn't listen to me, and I was looking at it, and I was like, I'm such a senior person, and I can't make a cut. And, you know, I had tears in my eyes, and everyone else was feeling sorry for me. And perhaps I felt sorry for myself, too. But what that allowed me to do was that a year later, I knew how to edit, and I knew how to do camera, and I knew how to be a producer and a director. And when we started our training department, I got to head it because I could really work with every department and connect different departments with each other. And when NDTV launched its own business venture, when we began to outsource services, I was the business lead for that. So sometimes when you're ready to go down to zero, it doesn't necessarily mean you're not going to come back really quickly with a new skill added to the skills you already had. But by this time, I had two children, and I was really missing them. I was watching, once in a while, I would switch from the news channel to the cartoon channel in the middle of the day to see what they would be doing at home. And I said to myself, this is not going to work for you for long. You need to go home. And I quit my full-time job. I quit not to stop working. I quit to be able to work flexibly. And I became a freelancer. I became a journalism trainer, a corporate trainer. And very soon after that, we had a third baby. I was pregnant again. And I became very, very sick during my third pregnancy. For a few weeks, the baby in my womb and I were on the brink. My doctors had panicked. My brother's a doctor in the US, and he was raising hell on the phone. And I realized, I mean, I went through an experience that was life-altering for me. I realized that there were people like me who looked like me, dressed like me, went to colleges and schools like me in Delhi, South Delhi, my doctors, who could look at an ultrasound scan, see a girl child, and tell me, come on, just get rid of it. This is not worth the risk. And just the experience of you feeling that if something goes wrong, I don't know how I will survive this. And everyone else around you doing some kind of mathematics. One child is really special. Two children complete the family. Three, and especially if it's a girl, super plus. It was a kind of alienation that I thought I would never come back from. My entire life was dependent on keeping this baby alive. And some of you are thinking, what is this woman doing? She's talking about pregnancy and family at a business summit, which is for entrepreneurs and financiers and networking opportunities like we've just had. And somewhere I wanted to bring this in because this is the reality of women's lives. The boundaries between our work life and our family life will collapse many times in our life. Work will invade family spaces and family issues, and I mean both happiness and sadness, will go to work with us. We will not always, we try to compartmentalize, we're very good at it, we multitask, we can do con calls with the child in the other room, we do a lot of stuff, but the boundaries are not watertight, they keep collapsing, and that's the reality. And we know that it's normal, but it's not seen as normal. And I think that's what we're doing here at SHEROES. We're normalizing what is an everyday reality. We are insisting, look, this is the way it is. And it's not a weakness, it's a strength. My role at work is critical. My role in the family is critical. And you're not going to use it to put me down. I'm going to use it to create something. As women have always been doing, we all know our nannies and daddies and mothers and aunts have always been doing that. So let's just make it official now. You know, the narrative that we don't hire single women because they get married, we don't hire married women because they get pregnant, we don't hire a lot of women because they don't do night shifts. We don't want to live in that world anymore. And this is about flex work, about work flex, about SHEROES. Men move jobs too, they move for money and power, and we think that that's more worthy than some of the more critical reasons that other people move for. I'm going to go back to the story of my work transitions where I left it off. When I first came home, the loss of a formal workspace was a massive vacuum in my life. But Facebook and Twitter were just coming alive. Social media was just kind of beginning to buzz in 2006, 2007. And one by one, people at work, our friends, our acquaintances, began to come on Facebook. And it became a kind of place where we could go and socialize for a bit in the day. People who work from home, I mean, people like me who used to be in an office and now work from home, for me, it was like the coffee corner. You know, you could go there for a bit. You could, you know, it was like sharing a smoke, bitching a little, exchanging some notes, complimenting each other. You look great, wonderful profile picture, et cetera, where you get this from. And then you get back to work. And I, because of what I'd been through, and because we had moved out of the city to raise our children, kind of made up for my physical isolation by beginning to express myself and write on social media. I was living this kind of, you know, extremely difficult to put into words life. There were, you know, there were all these moments of happiness because there were children in the house and they were growing up. I was depressed because I needed my work. I wanted to go out every day. I couldn't travel anymore. My husband, his work took him away, so I would spend a lot of time with very small children. And I began to Facebook, to blog, and to tweet about this life. I began to write about how the happiest time in my life was also the most depressing time in my life. How the time when I was, you know, when there was social media to connect to so many people, and I had this, you know, huge coterie of friends and colleagues that I was connected to, yet there was this isolation. And what was it? What was it that we that was getting to us? And I began to write the same stories in different ways on different social media. And I also needed to create something every day, which is what we were doing on television. So I began to do it on Facebook and on Twitter and on my blog. And it was like having a channel. Except that this time, all the credit came straight to me. And eventually, this led to a column that I write for Mint Lounge that I've now been writing for 3 years. And so it kind of, you know, again, that going from hero to zero moment led to the reinvention of a kind of new role simply because I stuck to it. And I just went on doing it day after day after day without losing the hope. I mean, without feeling that this was hopeless just because it wasn't paying me back. And eventually it did pay me back. I was teaching graduate and postgraduate level broadcast journalism, and I also then began corporate training, where I was able to apply my skills of training reporters to speak on camera and my in-depth knowledge of how the news industry works to mentor corporate spokespersons to face the media. So I would go and tell them secrets of what we do with their interview when we have it on tape, which is the soundbite that we're going to cut out. How do you create that soundbite? What's going to happen? You know, I could interview somebody and tell him, this is the headline tomorrow. This is the quote that we're going to put in. Do you want this to go? And if you know what your key message is, then how do you create, how do you make sure that that's the soundbite that goes on air tomorrow, that goes on the internet forever? And in return for your attention, I'm now going to tell you a really big secret. I have this confident veneer, and it gets better when I'm wearing good clothes. But behind it, I'm a real scaredy-poo, a big scaredy-poo. Every time I have to do something new, I just go under. I will go under blankets. Sairi has been calling me for 2 weeks and saying, do you want to share your presentation? And I'm like, Sairi, does anybody want to listen to my life story? There's no reason why I should go on stage. And you know, this huge drama, da-da-da-da-da, why should I do this? So I knew I was going to write this in the last 4 hours, which is what I've been doing, sitting outside. The first time I got a call to teach a proper broadcast journalism course from a very senior journalist from the Indian Express, and she said, Natasha, I've got this recommendation from NDTV, and we need you to design a course for us. Do you think you'll be able to do it? And I'm like, yeah, that's exactly what I do. And I had a six-month-old baby at that time. And yeah, sure, of course, yes. And when I put the phone down, I went screaming into my room and saying, mujhe kuch nahi aata, mujhe kuch nahi aata. I don't know how I'm going to do this. So that feeling of being a phony, of being fake, of being, you know, of actually at some point you're going to trespass and be found out, is a feeling that nags us all the time, irrespective of how much we achieve. It doesn't go away. And I guess what you learn, what I've learned in life, is that you've just got to treat it like some kind of street dog that is not going to go away, but it's not going to harm you either. So you just let it, you know, kind of be around your toes and throw it something if you need to, but carry on with your work. Because what's the worst thing that will happen? You'll do a mediocre job. Not so bad. Lots of people do that. And this really brings me to why Ochre Sky. Why do we do what we do? Because we don't know any other way. We want to participate in the world. We want to create. We want to connect. We keep wanting to get better at everything that we do, not just adults, so do children, not just men, also women, not just mothers, new mothers, also, you know, elderly ones. It's the basic human instinct to be competent, to shine, to share, irrespective of what stage in life you're at. My father doesn't want to retire. I don't want to lose my professional identity, even though I'm the mother of small children. So Rohit and I got together. We're both visual artists. He's a painter. I'm a photographer. And we love clothes. And he's been a designer. He's been in the industry for a long time. And we said, okay, this is the art that we live every day. And we're going to, you know, we're going to launch our own label. We're going to create our own label. And we'll go ahead. And it really brings together all of my interests: media, creation, social media, storytelling. What I want to share with you is some of the really silly, shameful, even shocking attitudes that I have discovered in myself in the last 7 months of being an entrepreneur. Sometimes I'll be saying to somebody, you know, I don't really make any money from Ochre Sky. As if it's a badge of honor, as if it's social work, as if it makes me noble that I'm doing something and not making money. And I'll be like, what are you doing? Sometimes we've got a new range and I won't post it on my Facebook because I'm kind of ashamed. Mere activist dost kya kahenge? Ye to capitalist ban gayi. I'm afraid of to offend my father, of offending my husband, my nephew, my uncles. It's unfeminine to be so money-minded. We launched Ochre Sky, but I wouldn't talk to anybody about it. I was afraid of being judged. I mean, one of my friends said, "Ab to tum aunty ban gayi, exhibition pe saari bechti ho," and it got to me. I was afraid that my other co-workers in the corporate sector, in the journalism sector, are going to judge me for starting from scratch. I was basically having a full-blown identity crisis. There's a young lady here, Srishti, who wrote to me in July and said, can you share the story of Ochre Sky with us? And I tried to write it, and I tried to write it, and I tried to write it, and I looked, and I came face to face with the fact that I wasn't comfortable inside me with what I was doing. And I had a conversation with my father, who's right here in this room as well. And Papa and I, we are big fans of each other. And he said to me one day, he said, you know, this business and all, it's not for people like us. You're an intellectual. You do writing. And the other thing he said was, you can't make money unless you have a tera mind. And then I got it. This is my conditioning. I've got it all mixed up with my ego. I'm an intellectual. Writing is respectable. Sales is not. It's a morality issue. It's dishonest to make a profit. It's a class issue. People will think I'm poor. My husband isn't making enough money. I'm over as a media professional, look. It's frivolous to do fashion. So ironically, I discover that I could wield a camera, I could storm male bastions, and be this chit of a girl carrying this big camera going all over the countryside, but I was ashamed of being seen with a measuring tape. Our first exhibition was in Calcutta, and I remember one of the thoughts was, at least nobody will see me. And I knew that I had to go beyond this, because really, who was putting me in a box? Not society, not my husband, not my in-laws. I was doing it myself. And I've learned to cross that bridge. It's come from the small successes Ochre Sky has, but it has largely come from SHEROES. I was able to do this because I knew Sairi. I've been following her on Twitter for years. We've connected, we've had lunch together. We've never quite figured out where our interests intersect. We just like each other's tweets. But when Rohit and I decided we had to do this, I knew that there was Sairi. There were SHEROES. I could go there and she would be able to start me off in a certain direction. So my first meeting with Sairi, she's like, you need to have a story. And I said, I want to sell clothes. And she said, Natasha, people don't buy clothes, they buy stories. And I'm like, okay, how am I going to explain this to Rohit? Because I don't understand what I'm doing. Then she put me in touch with Ishita, who is our first mentor. And we had this extremely successful meeting with Ishita in Gurgaon. She asked us lots of questions. She made a presentation. And when we were going back to Delhi from Gurgaon, Rohit was looking out of this window, and I was looking out of this window. And I'm like, what am I doing with this guy? He wants to make all this. He wanted to do wedding couture. I wanted to do Anokhi. And we were like, but what essentially had happened in these meetings with Sairi and Ishita was that they had asked us questions that we had been too polite to ask each other, that we had not known were valid, that we were, you know, we had not faced up to by ourselves. So it's not like it took a lot of time, but it was a connection that gave us a starting point. It was a connection that gives me confidence. I know I'm having trouble with a credit card terminal. I know I can call Sairi. I need a delivery partner. I can call Sairi. I need any kind of help. Ishita is there. Sairi is there. And that is something that has brought us where we are today. In my role as a media consultant, I met a CEO of a really large PR firm last month. And he'd been really busy, so because I'm the consultant to this big multinational company, so I know I have to act big there. So I'm sitting there and I'm saying, you've been really busy. And he said, yeah. I said, oh, that means you've got really good business going. And he's like, you know, Natasha, we have a lot of work. The challenge is to get people to pay for the work. And I'm looking at him and saying, that's Ochre Sky as well. So you know, we're not doing so badly if somebody with a 3,000 employee company has pretty much the same one-line description of where he is as us with our 30 karigars and, 7 months behind us. So I really want to just conclude with this. It's not just about knowing how to make business plans and learning Excel. That's important, and we need to do that. But it's also really, we need to examine our own attitudes. We need to look at where our conditioning has got us stuck, tap our networks, and don't be afraid to start from scratch. Or, you know, be afraid, but take that fear along. Don't let it stop you anywhere. Thank you.